when she's not working from a studio in the Mission that she shares with Eric Marinovich, she's traveling, giving talks, and inspiring people. I am glad we have the opportunity today to be inspired by her. Please welcome Jessica Hische.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. If I look slightly flushed, it's because apparently the person inside my body has a crush on Tanya's voice. Because that was one of the most distracting 30 seconds of my life. I'm like, whoa, okay, guys, chill it out. anyway, I'm really excited to talk to you guys today. The title of my talk is Art as Therapy, which was originally a little bit more kind of about the transition and existential crises I've gone through moving from being a non-parent to being a parent. But I've decided to reframe it because we're all kind of going through an existential crisis right now. So hopefully this resonates with you. I mixed things up quite a bit today. Anyway. But I thought I would start off kind of giving you a little introduction about how I got into lettering. And this is a path that I really recommend everybody follow. Like, just, you know, you can do your own thing, but this really worked for me. So if you feel like doing this yourself, like, feel free to copy. First, definitely decorate all of the trapper keepers of all the popular kids in your grade school. I was always on the cusp of popularity because I wanted to be popular so desperately that, of course, I could not be popular. But because I could draw everybody's names in a really badass manner, I was invited to stand on the periphery of many people's parties. And I will say that whatever you can use as your social capital, you know, like, really works. So go for it. Next, this step is maybe skippable, but, you know, start a cover band that you never actually plan to participate in because you just want to make t-shirts for your cover band. Mine was in the fourth grade. I made a Janet Jackson cover band called If, and then made a bunch of art for it, which I wish I could find somewhere. My mom saved, like, all of my weird, like, non-Far Side comics that I drew, but did not save a lot of this other early stuff. Next, on your Windows 95 machine, get a copy of MS Publisher and order a bunch of samples from Paper Direct and then make certificates about every member of your family, especially your brother and his worst farts in the world. I actually didn't really, this was like a total epiphany that I've been a graphic designer essentially since like the third or fourth grade without realizing it, because I was like obsessed with making fake certificates and stuff like that because we had all those like sports borders and things. And this is, like, I don't know if this is still a thing that you can do, but we had, like, foil that you could run through a laser printer that you could then, like, fake foil stamp onto, like, random laser printouts. It was pretty advanced. I have to thank my mom for being on top of technology. This one's really important, though. Like, make sure that you get a pair of flare jeans and draw, like, the most embarrassing shit ever on them about your band that you're really into, which I'm sure is Dave Matthews Band, and then you are thankful for the rest of your life that, like, 16-year-olds are not allowed to get tattoos of fire dancers, because you would for sure have one on the small of your back right now. This is probably the most important step, though, which is apply to art school and get in, and then have the most severe self-esteem fallout in the entire world, because you thought you were such hot shit being, like, the best at drawing in your tiny school in Pennsylvania, and then realize that, like, everybody else that you're in art school with has been going to, like, ceramic sleepaway camp since they were 7. So all of your, like, really well-articulated drawings of shoes, like, kind of, like, feel like garbage now. But it's all for the best. And in short succession, find graphic design so that you don't have to paint your feelings. Draw words for graphic design, and then draw only words. And now you are a lettering artist. So I didn't really understand lettering. I'll keep my, like, general introduction of myself pretty brief. I ended up working for Louise Fili after I graduated college, and I did a ton of lettering for projects when I was in art school, but I didn't actually understand that's what I was doing. I thought I was just being, like, really thrifty and avoiding buying fonts. And even when I worked for Louise, I mean, Louise didn't really call herself a lettering artist. She was always a graphic designer that incorporated a lot of hand-done type in her work. And most of the work that she and her staff do are very historically referential, so it does sort of feel like you're doing more, like, revival typeface work than you are doing custom lettering. But I did a lot of lettering while working for her, and it was really during that time frame that I kind of started to understand that this was what I really wanted to do with my time. And simultaneously, I had been doing a lot of freelance work and was doing a lot of really illustrative lettering. After I graduated, I sort of realized that I should have been in school for illustration all along, because really all I wanted was an excuse to draw all day, and illustration is that excuse. And even now, like, anyone that's within the lettering field kind of understands that it's far less of a graphic design profession than it is an illustration profession. Just the way that the entire world operates is very, very similar to the way that commercial illustration operates, and you work on the same sorts of projects with the same sorts of clients. And I, like, sort of ended up becoming, like, an illustrative letterer through that time. I was so stoked about discovering my love for type and lettering that I got the word type tattooed on my bicep in lettering, which the nerds are very happy to point out. And at the time, I was like, you guys need to stop being such crazy pedantic idiots and just, like, accept that graphic designers now own the word type, and it's like a master category for all things that include letter forms. And they're like, haha, that's not how this works, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, okay, whatever, until I started working with clients. And then, like, most of the time when they would use the word font incorrectly, they were just using it incorrectly. When they would say, like, I really like the font on that book cover that you made. And I'm like, oh, it's not a font. I drew it. And they're like, oh, I know. And I'm like, okay, that's not the right word then. So I would just accept at face value that, you know, whatever, graphic designers just aren't like the crazy semantics people that type people are. But every now and then, what would happen was, even though a job was, like, explicitly clear in what they were asking me to do of, like, draw this five-letter word, draw this five-letter font for our book cover or whatever, and then I would send them over a flattened TIFF of the art, they would go, where's the OTF file? And I'm like, you needed an OTF file of a five-letter word that's going to appear on one cover? Like, you actually were using the word font correctly. Now I should probably understand these terminologies. So after I sort of really started getting why all those different categories and subcategories were important, not only for getting clients to kind of understand where my role was within a project and what the deliverables would be, but also, like, how I could delegate stuff to other people when I really wasn't right for the job. Like, if someone came to me from a magazine and said, we need 50 headlines in 6 days and the budget is $2,000, and I'm like, you should hire a calligrapher, a brush calligrapher that can do this very fast. And so it allowed me to, like, delegate my work to other people and also kind of educate people about why it makes sense that people do more specialized work within this bigger industry. And I got so psyched about it that I went around telling everybody about all this stuff, and I spoke at, like, I think 70 or 80 conferences, something like that. I just spoke at American Greetings this last week, and now I'm speaking to you fine people, but you all know what that is because you're all a bunch of nerds. And one of the amazing side effects of this has been that the lettering industry, like, has completely blown up. Like, it's insane. And I definitely don't take all the credit for that, but I certainly did a lot of legwork advocating for this industry, which is awesome. And then, you know, you can't spit without hitting someone that does chalk lettering or something like that. If you just, like, search for any form of micro niche lettering on Pinterest, you'll just turn up pages and pages and pages of stuff. And which is really cool. It's just nice that people know what I do for a living. But the other thing that is hard and that I've had a harder time dealing with recently is sort of like struggling with this, like, am I a person that makes motivational posters for a living? You know, and, like, that's really hard. Like, I want to not have this be my reaction, but every time I think about these, like, how many fucking Mark Twain quotes are there, like, on Pinterest right now, like, every time that I, like, think about how many people are spending, like, you know, 40 hours on a thing that 1,000 people have drawn already, I get a little weird, and I get a little weird about my place in the universe. And I've been having these, like, creeping feelings lately where I feel like art is selfish. You know, and I think that we all get this feeling that, like, you know, people try and impose this feeling onto us that, like, because we love what we do, we shouldn't be paid. Like, there's all these sort of things like, well, I hate my job and I have $160,000 in debt, so therefore I should make a lot of money, but you love your job and didn't actually go to college. I went to college, but, you know, other people didn't go to college, therefore you should, like, make peanuts because you're not allowed to both get paid and love your job. And I, like, it's hard for me to not feel like sometimes the work that I'm doing is selfish because, you know, if what you're doing is like helping to sell soda, and you see other people in the world doing like crazy grandiose things, it's really difficult to sort of like feel okay about your position in the universe. And this feeling really started creeping in when I moved to San Francisco. And part of it is just because I didn't move to San Francisco and immediately had like a crazy posse of art-making friends. Like most of my friends upon immediately moving here were within the startup community because we moved here because my husband got a job at Facebook and everyone that we were meeting was like through Facebook or other companies. And it was really awesome. I mean, at first I was totally that person at the coffee shop being like, I can't believe all these people are talking about venture capital, how cool. And then like 2 seconds later, I was like, can't somebody just talk about a band already? But at the time it was like very novel and very cool and interesting. And then all of a sudden it started being like, man, everyone that I know is working on these huge projects that are like disrupting industries and changing the lives of people, sometimes in a real literal way, and sometimes in a like we pick up your laundry for free way. And I was having kind of a problem figuring out like how do I stay motivated doing the work that I'm doing if I feel like I'm not having that big of an impact. And what sort of helped me get around it at the time was like, okay, well, I love doing my work and I don't care that the work that I do isn't gonna help build wells in Africa all the time. I really love the process of doing it and I really am proud of the end result. So I can kind of counter that with my for fun projects, which give me a lot of personal fulfillment that make me feel like I am having impact in the world. So for a while, what I would be doing was basically working 24 hours a day and I would be working on client work that, you know, I would get a lot of artistic fulfillment out of, but I didn't get that sort of like deep in your gut fulfillment from. And then working on these educational projects on the side that, you know, really helped me feel like I was actually changing people's lives, even if it was on a much smaller scale than, say, you know, working at Facebook or doing something that is huge, like, you know, making a website where you can find printers. Like, I know that this is not like a life changer, but it's something that can be a huge inconvenience for people. And if I can make something that would help them out, why not? The most recent one I did was I created this email choose your own adventure tool on my website. So I love like doing writing and assisting people with like how to manage design business stuff. And my should I work for free flowchart that I made kind of blew up, which tells you whether or not you should work for free. And I wrote this really long post a few years ago about how to price artwork that I still get, you know, multiple emails a week about how people still reference it constantly to give them like permission to ask for real money for projects. And so I'm always kind of like, I love working within this world, even though I'm like helping other creatives instead of helping people that are like literally lifting people out of the gutter. It still feels really good. And doing these two things simultaneously was a way for me to really feel like I was getting a ton of artistic satisfaction from my work, but then also a lot of intellectual satisfaction from my for fun projects. But then something happened. And all of a sudden, I did not have all the time in the world to devote 24 hours a day to working on whatever projects I decided to work on. And so the issue with this, like having to separate these two worlds of like the for them and the for me, which is really the for money and for love, is that when you have less time to do everything, how do you choose? Like, you know, like I need to make money to support my family. I need to keep my career afloat. You know, like doing a lot of these side projects that have nothing to do with lettering are wonderful for me and I get a lot of fulfillment of them, but they're not actually the kind of things that bring client work in. I'm not doing a lot of for fun artwork projects on the side, which do help generate a lot of new client work. And one of the things that I did to sort of cope with this is I've always been really interested in making things that are useful. Like I wanna be a useful person. I'm like the same person that I was when I was a toddler where like I was just like, let me know what I can do to please you. And which, you know, works against me sometimes and works for me other times. But I really love making things that have a real world application out in the world. And even stuff that I've made that doesn't necessarily seem like that at first has like a deep undercurrent of it. So Daily Drop Cap was one of my first like big personal projects that I did. And it's one of the only like artwork focused side projects that I've done because you can say that everything else is like kind of artwork focused because it's a graphic design project. But For this project, I drew the alphabet 12 times in a row, which led to, 300 plus individual pieces of artwork. And I asked people, to watch along as I was creating them. I made one every single day, except when I was traveling or on the weekends, though I did try to catch up for a while there and it didn't work out. But the reason why the thing that really motivated me about this project wasn't even necessarily the artwork itself. It was the premise of why the artwork was being created, which was to make stuff that people could use. So like the whole premise of Daily Drop Cap, which not a lot of people really know in retrospect now, was that I made these drop caps and then gave you the copy paste image codes so that you can actually put them on your blog. And I said, if you have a site that is not some major commercial website, just feel free to use this all you want. And I think that's what got a lot of people to be really excited about it at first, because it wasn't just like a pretty making project. It was something that was trying to, give back to the internet. And it ended up giving back to me in a really big way because it brought so much work my way, which I would always be a hope, but it's one of those things I hadn't even thought about. I'm like, oh, of course I want more work, but who knew this thing that was basically like the world's best promotional tool would bring work in? Because at the time, I didn't think about it as a promotional tool. I think the best way to make a promo is to just make stuff and not expect it to come back to you, because ultimately the making it itself needs to be satisfying enough in case it doesn't come back to you. But this really came back to me in a big way. So these are covers that I did with Penguin Books, where they hired me to do 26 covers as a part of a series called Penguin Drop Caps. And I will take a breath now. I feel really amped right now. I had like a decaf coffee, which I think they lied about. But each of these was really, it was really interesting and different. And I love doing book covers because I feel like one of the things I also struggle with as a creative is like how to make work that feels like it has a permanence to it. And books are one of the few things where that these aren't just giveaways. These aren't just posters that are getting pasted up and torn down at the end of a season. They're things that people are choosing to bring into their lives or choosing to bring into someone else's life. And hopefully they can exist for quite some time. And worst case, they're donated to lovely places like the New York Public or the SF Public Library. And another area where I found this desire to be usefulness really fulfilled is in logotype work. So the kind of logo work that I'm interested in doing is this sort of brand revision work. And part of that is just because of practical reasons. I don't plan to set up a branding studio. I don't get off on brand extension stuff because I have total creative ADD and can't be on a project for more than 3 months. And I think while a lot of designers get into design and get really excited about having these 10 clients that they work with forever, that is honestly the scariest and most annoying sounding thing in the entire world to me. So I even clients that I love, I'm we're not married to each other, right? We could just hang out every Christmas party or something. And with this sort of work, this logo revision work, I'm able to do use my very kind of specialized skills and things that I'm interested in and do work for these clients that I feel is incredibly practical and useful. And I didn't really understand how much I love this until MailChimp came to me for the first time, which is the first brand revise I did. And after I had posted this to my site, I was like, you know what? A bunch of people are not going to understand that I actually redid their logo and didn't just do it in the first place. I should post a before and after and kind of talk through the steps of why I did it. I was super communicative with the client as I was working on it, and I think that transparency really helped. And just being transparent about the process that I went through to get to the final and about how every decision I was making was actually just really about legibility and practicality, all of a sudden it blew a bunch of people's minds open about wait, people think about this kind of stuff? Because we take that for granted as crazy type nerds that focus on details all the time, that a lot of people just forget that fonts don't just apparate into the universe. And sort of pulling the curtain back and showing people how the process was, which is something that not every designer feels comfortable doing, but I feel very comfortable doing. It made clients want to work with me more because they would feel empowered over the process of working with me. Like, they wouldn't feel like they didn't understand where the money went or they didn't understand where my time went. And what I really like to think about is, like, every time that I do a project like this, I've done a bunch of them at this point, like, I end up kind of going through and showing people, like, here's all the stuff that's really screwy about your logo, and then they can't unsee it, and they kind of have to hire me to do the whole thing. But none of it is, like, subjective, really. Like, some of it is subjective, but most of it is really just, like, do you want nerds with pitchforks to write articles on FASCO about you? Nope. Okay, then let me do this thing to your logo. Nerds with pitchforks as a threat is really, really effective with clients, I will tell you. Like, anytime a client wants you to do something and you're like, don't force my hand, just tell them that someone's going to write an angry article about them on the internet because, like, that thing that they're asking is really wrong. And they're like, well, we'll think, we'll whiteboard it for a little while and see if we still want to do it. But anyway, like, what I really love about kind of showing how the sausage gets made in this process is that I really like the idea that clients can become advocates for the kind of work that we do, because it can seem like so intense and so academic and so nerdy, but if I can explain to a client like everything that I've gone through to get to that final point, to the final logo, to the point that when they're out at a party and someone goes, really, is your logo that much better? Like, you know, was it worth that whole process of hiring someone else, like, and redoing all your signs and recutting that thing out of aluminum and blah, blah, blah? They can say, oh my God, you don't even know, like, there was this thing in the E that was just, like, crazy, you know? And they can kind of regurgitate a bunch of that nerd speak that I gave to them and feel really confident in the work that I've performed and also the fact that they've hired me in the first place. And that all that does is sort of advocate for our profession as a whole, which I'm really into. The most recent one I did, which I got to work with Jim Parkinson on, AKA he did the original logo and I did the update, Southern Living recently hired me to redo their masthead, which is not live yet, so this is total under the radar right now, so please no Instas. And they wanted to do something that was really adhered to the history of it, but worked with their new updated branding that they're doing, which they're totally revising the whole magazine. So the one on the top is Jim's original logo from the 90s, and then the new one is below. And I went through a whole mess of iterations to get to this point. This is just one page from one round. But it was, you know, these sorts of projects are really interesting because they're really, anyone that works with type knows that there's 1,000 variables that go into making one letter look one way or another. And being able to sort of explore all those on a really micro basis, and but still have this constraint of, like, it has to look like how it kind of has to look how it currently looks, makes it so that you don't get overwhelmed with the possibilities. And I really love constraints. So one of the things that you can deal with, though, is, like, feelings of uselessness if you're not doing useless work. But one of the biggest ways that this can really affect you is when projects get killed, which is an inevitable. So projects get killed. It's just a thing that happens. You just kind of have to, you can't be in love with anything that you work on. And what I've sort of realized, and I'll talk a little bit about this, is that, you know, like, if what really gets you off is that final piece and seeing it up on a billboard and seeing it on television or seeing whatever, you are going to be disappointed more often than not, because whether if someone messes with your art, if someone decides to change directions last minute, if the project it gets scrapped entirely, it can be really, really upsetting. And it's something that you deal with a lot more the further along in your career you are, when the projects that you're working on have, like, a much higher, there's more stuff at stake, where, you know, and the timelines are longer and more further out. So I could be working on something for 4 months, and then it's not meant to debut for 2 years, and then I find out 6 months before it's about to go live that they decided to scrap the whole project. And that kind of stuff can really grate on you over time. So here's a sampling of projects that have been killed over time. This was my first big kill. It was very upsetting. I got hired fresh out of school to do some work for what was at the time Gyro Worldwide, which is an ad agency in Philly. I don't know what they're called now. I forget. They changed their name a couple times. But they do a bunch of, like, cool industry stuff, including setting up the Art in the Age, which they do that, like, root liqueur that you can buy at Byright and all kinds of stuff. And they were going to put out this this alcohol called Rock and Rye, which is, like, an old Prohibition kind of mixer thing. And I could not have been more stoked. I was so excited about this. And I went so many rounds with them, and these were the two final pieces that I presented. And then I heard back, like, maybe 4 months later that they had scrapped it and went with, like, a really normal label-looking design. And I was like, I'm so sad. And then I didn't show it forever because I don't think I had permission to show it, but it's been, like, 11 years, so I'm going to say it's okay now. I did some ads for Glade that I was, like, pretty happy with how these turned out, but the thing that was so crushing about how this project ended was that the art director that I worked with accused me of phoning it in on the finals, and I was they were like, oh, we just aren't happy with the level of finish that Jessica did for the project, and I was just like, fuck you. I was so upset because I was like, you guys haven't expressed any upsetness over the course of this whole project, and now you're going to say that, and after the fact, you're like, I didn't even like you in the first place. And I'm just like, okay, fine, whatever. I did some work for Pottery Barn that was supposed to be on pillows, totally killed, still like it. This was one of my saddest killed projects because I loved it so much, and I show it all the time. I did some work for Amex, and this was going to be on like some New York Times billboard, and they totally killed it last minute. Anytime you work for cool people, just expect it to never happen. So I did this pattern for Burton that they were going to use on ski gloves and on a snowboard, and then they were like, ah, never mind. And I was like, cool. Sometimes stuff doesn't even make it past the sketch stage, so I did a bunch of like early sketch logo explorations for Nice and Easy based on a thing that they, which is a hair color company, a direction they were thinking about taking the brand, and it was all about like using these big swashes, and I had to draw a bunch of swashes and stuff like that. But it went a couple rounds, then just totally died at the gate, so whatever. But one of the bigger projects that I did recently that got killed that I was real upset about, but that it was still like a totally fine project, was I did a ton of work for the Oscars last year that did not make it into the show. But this project, like, I feel like most of the time when you're working on projects and they get killed, the process of working with on it and with the people that you're working with is still so enjoyable that you like walk away going like, well, that's a shame because I'm really proud of that work, but ultimately that was still fun and I'm glad you paid me, blah, blah, blah. And so for this project, I worked with the Academy and their creative team, and they were just so awesome to work with. And what happened was they hired an agency that did a bunch of exploratory work with like digital brush pens, like super quick in like a slide deck. And the creative director was like, oh, hey, like this is like the approved direction, but I know it could be a lot better. Could you take a few stabs at like helping us make the typography better? And I was like, yeah, are you kidding? Awesome. Like 100% I'm in. And then over the course of this, too, he was like, and you know, like, if you want to go to the show, like, I could probably get you tickets. I guess everybody's got to go once. And I was like, yep, that's a thing that everybody's got to do. You know. So I was like, uh-huh, I will go to the Oscars. Sounds great. So I got to go to the Oscars last year, which was pretty surreal. I threw this direction in as, like, a random because I was like, everybody loves pretty scripts. So worst case, maybe they'll like that. Which they did, which was great, but then they killed it the morning of the Oscars, so whatever. Which was great because I accidentally spent $400 on a haircut because I asked a friend of mine in LA, like, I need to get my hair done before the Oscars. Can you recommend someone? She's like, oh, you should go to my old hairdresser. She's a little expensive, but, you know, like, she does a really good job, and she does a bunch of people for the show. And I was like, okay. And I went, and it was just like a total 45-minute run-of-the-mill haircut, and I went to check out, and it was $400. And I was like, ugh, like, could not have anticipated that because I get expensive haircuts, i.e. they're $90. So a little bit expensive, I was like, okay, like $150, I can cough it up for the Oscars, but woof, that was a lot. And then when I got an email from the creative director that morning being like, oh, I know we told you that thing was going to be on the program, but it won't be there. I don't want you to be surprised if you, like, show up and it's not there. And I'm like, great. But this was all still really fun to do, and I mean, honestly, I had such a good experience working with them that I would have kept going forever. This was what was supposed to be on the program, and then ultimately they killed it because they felt like it didn't match the rest of the show. And if you look at the campaign from last year and hyper-analyze the lettering that they ended up using, you will notice that it is the original sketch that was presented in the slide deck to them. And what ended up happening is it's very designed by, like, you know how things are, that it's very designed by committee, and people just got more comfortable seeing a certain piece of artwork over time, and there's just so many cooks in the kitchen that they, you know, we're just like, whatever, it's approved, like, we're comfortable with what we know versus what we don't know. But they did use a little bit of my art on a stamp that they sent out for the voting, and also the word vote for voting for the nominees. So that was pretty cool. So fancy people got to see my art, but not most people. Anyway, so what I've sort of discovered through like having just dozens upon dozens of things killed over the years is that the journey to the end of a project really is as important, if not more important, than the destination. And when I talk to designers and creatives of all types, or even just like anybody that's in college, anybody that's in high school, and they're thinking about what they want to do for a living, I really try to get them to focus on like, don't think about what the end result is, or what the title is, or what the accolades are, or you know what your LinkedIn resume says. Think about what your actual day-to-day life is in that profession, because that's what you're shooting for. Like, what you're shooting for is to really like 80% of your life. Because if we're gonna be real, like none of us are retiring ever, you know, like, I mean, we'll probably like downgrade the amount of stuff that we're doing, but based on like the fact that we're all gonna live until we're like 125 years old, I'm gonna say that most of us are gonna be working a huge chunk of our lives. And it would be really upsetting if we all just sort of stood back and said like, oh, cool, well, I hate my job, but it doesn't matter because like, you know, 60 years down the line, I'll be able to take 10 years to myself to like be okay with that. And I really like the idea of like spending most of my time doing something that I enjoy. And of course, there's stuff that you do on a day-to-day basis that it's just out of duty and not out of love. But if I can just make sure a majority of my day is filled with something that I love to do, I think that, I mean, it doesn't matter if it never gets printed. It just matters that I love that process. And sort of understanding like what needs to be a part of that process has just taken time. You know, like I've given a lot of talks about what my process actually is. Here's like kind of a snapshot. But one of the things that I find funny is like every service ever and every like design focused startup is always trying to find ways to make your process faster. You know, like let's do this more efficiently. Let's automate this part of the process. Here, try this brush. Here, try this whatever. And I couldn't be less interested. Like, I'm always looking for ways to make my process slower. If anybody has a shortcut, never tell it to me. I don't want to know it because I want to take twice as long as you are taking to do that thing because I like doing the thing. It's very meditative. It's important to me. I know how long it takes me to do the thing that I'm doing. And there's not, like, you know, racing to the end is not a goal. Like, I think that, and that's like a general life advice thing, you know, like, it's really cool having babies. Don't necessarily race to that point. Like, you know, you've got a whole life of baby having time. It's cool. Well, at least, you know, a significant chunk of time in your 20s and 30s and 40s. But yeah, I mean, we're always just looking to tick off these boxes of like, I have to race to the top of my career. I have to like be, you know, I have to get to the top of my profession. I want all the accolades. I want all the awards. I want to be like, you know, at the top of the mountain. But the issue is like the faster you get to the top of the mountain, the longer you have to spend at the top of the mountain. And it's much easier to be on a slow upward climb to the top of the mountain than to be like standing on the top of the mountain, pushing all the other people off of the top of the mountain. Not that you're pushing people off, but, you know, it gets crowded up there. I don't know. Longevity is hard. So one of the things I've been thinking about a lot lately is taking myself more seriously. This is a very California thing, I think. I'm in therapy now. I don't know many people who aren't. If you're not, I recommend it. It's very useful for so many things. But I just remember getting out of art school and just being like, I can't believe these fine artists, blah, you know, whatever. Because when I was in school, I like wanted a way to draw all day, but I felt like all of my feelings were super dumb and immature. And, you know, I got into school somehow making paintings about my boyfriend like this. this was my senior project in my senior year of high school, just so you guys know. But I was a very sensitive kid, and, you know, I, like, sat around all day listening to Smashing Pumpkins and, like, painting stars on my ceiling and thinking I was super deep. And then once I got to art school and saw that, like, people were making real projects about real topics that were, like, incredibly, like, thought-provoking and whatever, I immediately, like, totally shut down my ability to make fine art at all. I was just like, clearly I'm a crazy person, or just like a silly little girl, and my feelings aren't valid. And it's taken a long time to kind of feel like I can make art that's self-expressive again and give myself permission to do that. Really, like, I had been doing it once I've discovered graphic design as, like, a medium, because it felt like as long as I could be, like, sarcastic or, like, you know, make something useful or whatever, I could inject my feelings into that thing. So probably the most feelingsy thing I made in school was I made a board game about divorce called Pack Your Baggage. It was my senior project. My parents are divorced. I don't know who else's parents are divorced. Woo, yeah. It's a great thing, I guess, for our parents eventually when they're finally over it. But which they are now, it's cool. Everybody's happy, whatever. But when I made this, I was like, I had just gotten out of the real thick of it, was still kind of in the real thick of it. And I didn't really make this as like a catharsis project. I wanted to just make something that I felt like I could have a sense of humor about that I felt was really close to me, you know, like something that I felt like I had enough experience to like throw at so that I didn't feel like people would be like, way to make a project about a thing you know nothing about. But I'll give a little brief explanation. It worked like the game of life, except instead of choosing between career and college, you chose between mom and dad. And like the game of life, you would get these like chance moments that would affect your gameplay. So one of the chance moments was you chose like your parent's personality from a deck of cards, and then depending on what your parent was like, it affected how many negative baggage points you would earn when getting caught doing things. So like if you had the like alcoholic parent and got caught drinking in high school, it would be kind of like zeroed out. You know, it's like, nah, whatever. Of course that was gonna happen. But if you had the like super religious parent and you got caught fucking your teacher or something, then that was like, you know, triple points or something. But what was great was that these points worked in both directions. So like if you did a thing to get caught, which was you rebelling against your parents' divorce and trying to be like an adult person, I should probably not be cursing on a New York Public Library thing, but I'm sorry. Or a San Francisco Public Library. Sorry, I'm an ex-New Yorker and I can't erase it from my mouth. But if you caught your parents doing things, you could collect guilt money to pay for therapy to take away baggage. So. And you got these two blame it on divorce cards, which like, I don't know if anybody here ever was like, if you guys weren't divorced, I would have done that awful thing that I did. But you get like one, maybe two times in your whole life that you can do that. So you save it for something really good. Like, that's not like a I cheated on a test card. That's like a I got knocked up after prom card. Which I did not do. I only have one child and she is two. Prom did not happen 2 years ago. Though maybe it did, nah. Anyway, and then so now, you know, making self-expressive work I feel like is really important. And it's been hard for me to want to make stuff that's like really topical about stuff that I'm feeling about without feeling like I'm maybe even taking advantage of a situation or doing something that isn't gonna have an impact or doing something that's just kind of like following the trend of what everyone else is doing. So, you know, a lot of people made comments after, you know, the election basically saying like, man, this is great news for artists and comedians, you know, who are gonna be able to have just a wealth of things to work from for the next 4 years, which, you know, my initial thought was like, oh, like it just, that was like not the thought that I wanted to have. And I had a hard time even thinking about making art, anything related to what's going on right now until recently. But what I sort of realized is that like, you don't need to give yourself, you don't need permission to make work, you know, like, and I'll talk a little bit more about this in a second, but like any excuse to just like get you creating and doing the thing that you feel like you were put on this earth for is good. And like, don't feel like outside forces need to limit you in what that thing is or outside perceptions. And I think that we all struggle with that our whole lives is like, I want to do this thing, but what will people think of me if I do that thing? And like the people that have real success in the world are just the ones that go like, I don't care, I'm gonna do this thing. And they just keep going. And certainly like do that as long as whatever you're doing isn't hurting people. But it's really important to like give yourself permission to sort of do what feels right in the moment. I used to do a ton of letterpress printing when I lived in New York because I had this relationship with the ARM letterpress in Williamsburg, which is an awesome space and run by a really rad dude who's also a major type appreciator, Dan Morris. And it's how I met Nick Sherman, who's doing a workshop that you guys should all take. But I didn't really understand how important letterpressing was, like, in my creative process, mostly because having access to a space and being able to sort of order prints or order plates really easily and, you know, like, have an idea on a Monday and print by a Friday, what it did was it, like, took the resistance between me making something and me making something real and, like, really turned that resistance down. Like, suddenly it was, like, pretty inexpensive for me to do it. I didn't feel like I had to have these, like, insane justifications for making a poster. And once that got taken away, like, once I moved over to San Francisco, I know that there's resources here. I know there's San Francisco Center for the Book. But I just never did it. Like, I never formed those relationships. And what happened was every time that I wanted to make a print, I would have all these, like, very business-related considerations about it, of just, like, oh, well, I really want to make this thing into art, but then if I'm going to make it, if I'm going to sell it, then I have to make sure that I print X amount so that I don't have to sell it for $1 jillion. And then if I'm going to print X amount, then I have to, you know, have this whole inventory. And then if I'm going to have the 1,000 prints lying around, then I should make something that's going to really sell because I can't make weird art because no one's going to buy weird art. And then all of a sudden, all that that did was I went from, like, making stuff constantly to not making anything at all. So the, like, resistance between, like, just having an idea and putting it out there and making it into a real physical object became so intense that I just decided, like, I was just too afraid to make anything. And so recently I purchased a Vandercook, and I know that it's, like, you know, it's easy for me to la-la-la away the money of the fact that I actually bought a letterpress, but it essentially is, like, a large chunk of money that has been, like, the best therapy I've ever paid for, because all of a sudden I just started making stuff again, you know, like, just any random idea. Like, I wrote a woman today who I liked a quote that she wrote on Twitter about, like, the quote was, like, now seems like a really good like, it seems like the only way to live right now is to give no fucks and a whole lot of dams. And I was like, that is such a good quote. And so I wrote her and I was like, I'm gonna make that into a poster, are you cool with that? And she was like, yeah, do it. But, like, previous me might have said, like, oh, I really want to do that. Oh, but it's going to be really expensive. I should only do it if I'm going to do, like, a limited edition run. But then if I'm going to do a limited edition, it has to be X amount of money, blah, blah, blah. And all that stuff is just, like, prevents me from actually making the artwork in the first place. And now that I have a lot less resistance to, like, making things, it's opened up the world to me to actually suddenly want to make art for fun again, which is huge. You know, like, when you go from making all of your art for clients and making, you know, educational projects and websites for fun to, like, finally making art for fun again, it's like, I feel like a 22-year-old that's like, I mean, I'm just happy to be here mode, you know, like, which I feel like if I need more of that in my life, and I think we all kind of do. And what I sort of realized, like, through all this and through, like, paying attention to what everyone's dealing with, is that if making something gives you the strength to get out of bed, that's enough. You know, like, do not feel like everything that you make needs to change the world, because it doesn't. If anything, it just needs to get you motivated to be a better person. You know, like, that's one of the things that is really important, is just, like, making sure that you feel like you're capable of taking on the world and that you're going to be out there and be a positive force for other people to be positive forces. And, like, this reaction is so toxic. Like, I love Liz Lemon. I feel like she's my spirit animal, but I also... like, this, like, inner cynic of me, like, anytime I find myself, like, rolling my eyes at someone's project because I'm like, I don't think they donated enough of the proceeds to a charity to justify making it for a charity or whatever. Like, anytime I have that reaction where I'm just like, oh, that person's being a dick, I have to just think, like, whatever. They're doing their thing. No judgment. Everybody's allowed to do their thing. And a quote that is, like, a totally generic airplane quote that really sticks with me, and that I use all the time when I think about, like, whether or not the work that I'm doing is selfish, or whether, like, I should justify my actions, or whether, like, how am I going to move forward when things are really stressful, is put on your oxygen mask before helping others. And this is really, I mean, I think self-care is really huge, and San Francisco is thankfully a place that is very supportive of it. But really, really think about it a lot when you're making work, and don't feel like work that you're doing, even if it's, like, to sell toothpaste or whatever, is, like, not worth it if you're getting something out of that process and that you're excited to go to work and make that thing. Because I think what we're all kind of working with right now is, like, how do we move forward? Like, how do I go out into the world and behave like a normal human when, like, clearly it's not normal times? And just know that, like, you need to be your best self in order to exist in this world and help other people be their best selves. And you might not be the person that is on the front lines, but you can help enable that person by encouraging them or doing whatever it is that you're going to do to like get them to move forward. So yeah, so that is all I would say. I have found that while therapy has been incredibly helpful for dealing with a lot of things, what I really needed all along was just like permission to make stuff for me again, and to not judge whatever it is that I'm doing, you know, not allow myself to judge myself or allow other people to judge me for the actions that I'm making, as long as whatever I'm doing is gonna help me become a better person for my family and for the world. So, thank you.
We have some time for questions. First of all, thank you, Jessica.
Thanks.
Does anyone have one question? Just one.
Everyone's very shy.
Okay, we got first. Can you pass it along?
Sure. Hello? Just wondering, over the course of your career, how, like, where you get your inspiration from and how that's changed, and whether, like, living in New York or living in San Francisco, like, the impact that has on your work.
So the New York-San Francisco thing, the main issue with that is being surrounded by a bunch of crazy workaholics in New York, like, allows you to be, enables you to be a crazy workaholic. Because if everyone around you is bragging about, complain bragging about how they worked on a Saturday, you're like, oh yeah, I work every Saturday too. Like totally. And it just changed, like the work culture around you really does affect you. So like, I have a lot of sympathy for people that live in places where they just don't have a ton of super creative people around them that are really passionate about what they're doing, because it is really hard to keep that up on your own for a long period of time. So what I would say is I have a lot of really motivated people around me, but people keep like much more regular human hours here, which has been incredibly helpful for me in my life. And I think I really needed it. Like I needed to kind of take it down a notch and not rely on high level, like high volume output, and instead rely on high quality output. But I do miss being a direct part of the culture that I really, most of my work goes towards. Like a lot of my clients are still in New York because of publishing being centered there and advertising on a more global level being centered there. So I do miss being in like an area where you can't spit without hitting a graphic designer. In terms of inspiration, I think like inspiration is really different than influence. You know, like I think a lot of people when they ask what your inspirations are, they're actually asking what your influences are. And I don't think my influences have changed all that much over time. Like I'm still inspired by like vintage typography and like people like Chris Ware and things like that. But I'm more like influenced by people around me than anything. Like I am a total like sponge of the energy of other people that I hang out with, and like sharing spaces with creative people. Like I share a space with Eric Marinovich. Like it can be like really daunting when you see other people doing a ton of work that's really awesome and creative, but it can also be really inspiring. So I think like I try to get influence from a lot of other things and inspiration from a lot of things, but on individual projects, more often than not, it's like the content of the project itself that I draw the most like influence and inspiration from. Because really like, and that's why I have a hard time doing work that isn't client work, because I basically like need the brief in order to move forward, and giving myself a brief is much harder, and it's more rare that I have a desire to make artwork just for like because I feel this fire under me to make a specific thing than it is to have something stumble into my inbox and me go, I already know what I'm going to do for that, you know. But yeah.
Anyone else?
Hi, Jessica. Thank you for sharing your time with us. Where do you fall in with the street signs, the street corner signs in San Francisco going from all caps to initial caps?
Oh. To be honest, I have not noticed. But no, I'm all for title case signage. I feel like, you know, there's more, it's easier to perceive letter differences in lowercase. So I would say, as far as legibility, maybe it's a good move. I don't know. It's one of those things. I'm not a legibility expert on signage, so it's hard to know like what everyone would benefit most by. And my brother actually sent me, speaking of like legibility stuff, my brother, who is not an art person, sent me like one of those like fonts really matter, like forward emails where like everything looks like the C word or whatever. And one of the things, one of the images in this email was this pizza company, and it said like something pizzas. And like, I had to wait for it. I was like, what is this supposed to read as that I'm not reading it as? And it was like someone was reading, saying that you should read it as like the N-word in plural. And I was like, that's just a script Z. Like, you know, people just, this is, you would only read it as that if you've literally never seen a script Z in your entire life, if that you would read that as a lowercase g. And so, like, I think legibility and stuff like that is so interesting because it does shift, like, depending on people's exposure. So, like, while, you know, universally they say, like, typesetting books in a serif typeface, you know, is the most legible and easy to read and most invisible and therefore doesn't affect your reading experience, is it going to be that way forever? I don't know. Like, there's certainly people that are going to, like, can't read a script lowercase z or, like, read a more calligraphic p, the one where the bold doesn't connect. Like, that was meant to look like an n or something. And I was like, that's just a script p. That person just never saw script P before. And so, yeah, I mean, it's like, it's hard to judge it not from the nerd standpoint instead of the random person standpoint.
I have a question about, I guess, being a female designer in, I think, what it seems like generally an agency type of hours. And I think, how do you think motherhood has affected that? And also being able to play with like career, time management, and also being able to do all the things that you love.
Here's where we get into the darkness. So I love being a mother. It's amazing. I'm so obsessed with my family life, and I feel like now, like, the things that I struggle with more have to do with, like, I never had to worry about work and career. Like, that was always my safe zone ever since I was a little kid. Like, I was a total compartmentalizer with, like, my priorities in my life, and I would just lean super heavily on academic work or on artwork or whatever, whenever I had problems going on in other parts of my life. And this is the first time in my life where, like, my whole personal life is good. You know, like, usually there's, like, some random person that's, like, really just making me have meltdowns in the middle of the week, and I can bury myself in work to deal with that. But everything has been so outstanding, you know, in terms of personal life. I haven't had the identity shift that a lot of women experience, where they can't separate themselves from being a mother, or feel that motherhood takes over their person. That's just has not been my experience. Part of it might just be because I'm like kind of a like goldfish crackers, they're fine, whatever. You know, like I'm like a little looser than a lot of like the more intense. You know, Bay Area style moms, which I have many of them are in my friend posse who like, you know, order special formula from Sweden because they found out it's the best or whatever. And I'm just like, it's not available at Walgreens. I'm, you know, whatever. So like the transition was hard in a lot of ways, but it was not hard in terms of my personal identity. The way that it is extremely hard is that I never felt like I had any issues being a woman in the design field, like never. Like I would get interviewed all the time being like, what's it like to be like a woman in like a male dominated field? Do you feel like there's sexism, whatever? And I must have been like one of the lucky ones that like never really dealt with like overt sexism and really felt like more than anything, people were just like, please come sit at the table. It's all dudes here, like we need you, you know? And I felt like I was given a lot of opportunities specifically because I was a woman. And I think certain things like public speaking, I think that, you know, I get a lot of public speaking requests. Like part of it is because I have a lot of experience, but part of it is because there's no conference that's like, you know what we need? More male voices, you know? And so there's like a lot of things where I feel like being a woman has really been an advantage, you know, like, and I know that not everyone has that experience because I never worked at an ad agency. I never worked at like one of those very, you know, a more misogynistic environment. Like I've always worked in these very, you know, inclusive environments. But the thing that that happened is, like, once I got into my 30s, and I don't think this is necessarily even motherhood specific, it just has to do with, like, everyone's life, the life course, is that all of a sudden it became a lot more awkward to have intense friendships with men, because everybody started getting married and everybody had a lot less time because they were managing family or doing whatever. So it's not often that I'm, like, getting random drinks with a male colleague on a Tuesday, because maybe that person has, you know, who knows whose partner is jealous, who knows who would be, like, putting the other person out, who has a kid at home or whatever. And so I have found that my social group has become more segregated along gender lines, like, hugely, since being in my my late 20s and early 30s. So if you would have asked me when I was, like, 26, like, if I thought being a woman affected my career, I'd be like, are you kidding? Like, it's been all rainbows because of being a woman. It's awesome. Like, as long as you drink whiskey and can go to the bar and hang out, you're good. But I will say that, like, I'm lucky in that I'm surrounded by a lot of really awesome, really motivated power women, but I know that that's not the case for everyone. So I could see how, if you were in a market where a lot of the leadership positions are occupied by men, and that's just, like, it seems immovable, and that's going to be forever, that, like, over time, you start losing those people as friends and start surrounding yourself with their wives. And, like, not that everybody's not an awesome human to hang out with, but you're not going to get the same career benefit as being around other people in leadership positions within an industry. So I would say that that had the biggest effect. And I think the being a parent thing, the issue is that the, you know, sort of expectations around being, like, a designer that's really prolific is based on the schedule of, like, a 25-year-old unencumbered childless person who's extremely healthy. You would have to be, like, just throwing piles of money on me to get me to work on a Saturday, because it's so much more, like, it takes too much away from my life to spend that much time away from my child. And it's too much to negotiate with my husband to, like, be like, oh, by the way, you're on full parent duty all weekend because I have this project that I'm mildly excited about that doesn't pay very much that I want to work on. So it's, your priorities do shift. Like, you only say yes to those sort of, like, working late into the evening projects or working on the weekend projects if it's really something that you want to do, whether it's for the money or because it's a really, really cool project. And that over time, I think, can have a huge impact on your work. You know, like, you have to be much more on top of it. You have to be really into, like, promoting yourself and being out there. And that's something that I never really had to do because I was always such a high volume outputter that, like, the work itself was the promotion. But now that I'm outputting at a much lower volume, I have to remind people, like, hey, just so you know, still available for work. And when I moved to Oakland, everyone assumed that I was working from home now, and I still have a studio here in the city. When I had my daughter, I had art directors emailing me when she was 11 months old, 12 months old, after I had already been back at work for 7 months, saying, I don't know if you're back at work yet, but I have a project that might be good for you. And I just don't hear any stories of men dealing with that. Like, I don't know any men who, a year into having a child, someone's emailing them saying, like, I don't know if you're available for work, but I have a project that might be good for you, but I'm assuming that you might be at home taking care of your child. You know, like, that's just not a thing. And I think it's something that is more specific to women that work for themselves than for women that have a company that they run and have employees or are an employee somewhere else. So there's just not a lot of us. I mean, if you really think about people that are out in the world that are vocal about being parents, that are working for themselves, there's a handful. I mean, it's very small. So there have definitely been some hiccups, and that's why the internet does not know about this child. Like, my Facebook page knows about this child, but the internet at large does not know about it. And it's just because I don't feel like dealing with the fallout that I had with my daughter. And it's been really hard to wrap my head around that because I'm just such a big sharer. Like, I want to tell everyone everything that's going on in my life all the time. But it's really, to me, it's not worth the repercussions of doing it again. And it's a hard pill to swallow because I want to be out there advocating for women and talking about how difficult it is. But what I have found, and I'm sure other people that have dealt with hardships in their life have dealt with this, like, no matter what it is, whether it's, like, not saying a child is a hardship, but, you know, it affects your life. But, like, if you deal with something, everyone wants to hear about your story after they know you're over it, you know? Like, no one wants to hear about, like no client wants to hear like, oh, I'm currently dealing with schizophrenia, but please hire me to do stuff. Like they want to hear about how you've battled with something and that you're totally fine and healthy and everything's cool. And now you have this really great story about how you like overcame this hardship. But like parenting is hard because you're never overcoming it. You're always in the middle of it. So like it's a hard thing to talk about without it really affecting people's perception of your availability and what kind of work you're open to doing. So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jessica.
Thanks, you guys, for coming.